important problem we need to study. We are hearing tonight, I think, some flexibility around what happens when a resident who's over 19 attends. Now, one of the issues first raised for the whole study was there's confusion because people don't know where to go. There will be people rocking up for Wirral and Cheshire, people from Wirral rocking up wherever the centre is, who will be more my age group, no doubt. And I trust they're not going to say, sorry, you're too old, go away. That people, because they're committed to a service, will offer a service rather than be blunt. So it seems to me there's going to be a need for a learning and transitional period, and perhaps over several years. I don't think you can suddenly introduce something and say, bang, this is the new thing. People are going to rock up. And so even if we do designate, say, Eastern as 0 to 19, because we've clearly seen the need for children and the need for people from housing court, as I call it, sorry, there will be people coming over the border who are older than 19 and will hope to have a service. So we have to have flexibility. I'm very grateful for your time, Chair. I've taken quite a bit of time, put some stuff together, and in producing my CAC, I've been open with it. I don't want to interfere in your deliberation. Points and pointers. I hope that whatever comes out, whatever time scale, is equal to or better than what we have now.
I think, to be honest, Councillor, the reason for you both to be here was because of the closeness of where your ward is. So I think that the information we put together, the question you asked, are really helpful.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think this is really useful. And I think that it demonstrates, certainly putting something together like this, demonstrates your commitment to the people of Eastern and South Wirral in terms of ensuring that there is adequate and appropriate delivery services. So I really appreciate this. And I both for being here, obviously, being from South Wirral, where, as we said, as I said from the start, that there's that crossover. You mentioned just a couple of things I didn't know, just what's on offer cover. And if we look at page 2, the extended access is 3 hours on a Monday through Friday, and then 9 to 6 Saturday and Sunday, and 9 to 2. So that's the extended access that's being offered within West Cheshire. That coupled with what our proposals are, I don't obviously have the figures to handle the numbers of the patients. You know, we have to look at how many are utilising the services. But that, along with what we are proposing to offer, I believe would cover that crossover. And Laura from the commissioning side at West Cheshire mentioned that the appointments that they have currently aren't utilised. And actually, again, it goes back to over contact communication and how we get those messages across, isn't it? It's about utilising and being aware that it's a 0300 number that patients can phone within West Cheshire on that border to access those extended access appointments if required. So looking at what the offer is from West Cheshire and also what we're proposing to offer, I think that should cover certainly those patients. But it's about utilising the services that are there as well and ensuring that patients are aware that they are there and are able to access those. Learning over several years you've written, I can't imagine for one moment that what happens from the beginning of April next year will be a transition straight away on the 1st of April, and there we go, that's our new service up and running. There has to be a transition, there has to be a crossover, there has to be learning through several months and years. As you say, we've been trying to do this for a long time, and we haven't got it right yet, so we do have to get it right now. And there has to be that transition period, because how could we go from one to another just overnight? And so that would be a commitment. But certainly as a commissioning organisation that we would give, that it can't just change overnight. There has to be a transition period. And so the patient population are aware. And also, as I said earlier, that we work together, because you're seeing residents on a regular basis in your surgeries, all of you. And we work together to get that message across. And you mentioned also the third point I mentioned about the was flexibility. And what I said earlier to Councillor McManus, we're taking on board the comments that are coming back through this consultation. and it is about listening, and it is about taking all of that on board and looking at how can we do things. And not being rigid, healthcare, the delivery of health and care isn't rigid. It has to be flexible because it has to meet the needs of our population. And so we have to take that on board and listen and learn from that.
So, I think also where we are, as you've heard from your two speakers and references, heard from Laura that what you have in West Cheshire is a different offer. It's a different way of delivering the same. So there is, I'm a resident of West Cheshire. So the Council of Chester has the ME department, it has the urgent treatment centre on site, and there's no other walking facility. But there is six locations spread across West Cheshire, which equally would have issues of rurality, transport access and so on, which you are going to be able to access GP, extended GP access. Our extended GP access, whilst there are still issues of rurality, transport and access, is 21 different locations at this time, and that has to happen regardless of what happens to walking centres. We have to have an urgent treatment centre, we have to have an AME. The imposition, I suppose, of the urgent treatment centre means we do then have to look at how the rest of it works and fits in the middle, because there's no more new money for that. So, and that is why we were open, and we understand there is some work being done at the moment by the providers about how they perhaps come back with an offer that meets some of the concerns we've heard and enables us to move forward with the support of scrutiny. About looking at how we can be flexible about entirely the issues that you have identified about the 20-year-old woman turning up with her, perhaps having a mum and her two kids, all the flows in from West Cheshire as well, and how we can perhaps make things like booking for the dressings more acceptable. So we are absolutely open, and you know, tomorrow signals the end of part of the process, and the start of actually some really fairly heavy thinking based upon the evidence we've heard.
Thank you. Can I just ask one point?
Yes.
What we take in is new money.
Yes.
What we know about the guarantee of that money for future years?
That savings based money for future years.
Thank you. I just wanted to there was a figure in the year of this 30 extra visits a day. And it just reminds me this UCC of the film, the Kevin Costner movie, if you build it, they will come. So, you know, I've got this idea that you build this UCC thing, I'm sure you need more than 30. They will get there, what, don't you not think? Well, there you go. So, that's a big concern because in Easter, for instance, and I've asked for the figures of this, I still haven't done it yet. I must go through FOIs and get that for after. When our ward was closed at the time, for that period, all we got was inundated with the taxi fares 38 and the turn. Couldn't get the buses, which wasn't your fault, but wasn't taken into account because you didn't know about it, etc. etc. And I asked, so the only option people have is they want to go, now. They'll just pick up the phone and ask for an ambulance. Mm-hmm. And that really concerns me because one of the issues we have is I was at I'll quite a lot in early seasons. And every time I'm there I see 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12 ambulances sitting outside. It's ridiculous. So one of my big concerns about this is, no matter which way we go, what pressures is going to be put on A&E ambulance service south because we're so far. £6 taxi. For us down right at the bottom, it's a huge expense, and the likelihood is, along with two small children, as Mrs. and two of us were together, they will phone that.
Yeah. And it's 13 miles from Bridal Road to our office.
And so
I fully understand what you're saying, but if I bring you back to what we said at the outset, this isn't about everybody going to the urgent treatment centre. I know you. I fully understand what you say.
I think
patients will go there, but actually, we have to work together to really get the message across that whatever comes out of our consultation and whatever is agreed in terms of the way forward, that that's communicated in the right way. And we can do this because we can do it together. Like I said, you see the coordination in your surgeries on a weekly basis. It's about getting that message across. We can't work in silos anymore. For far too long, health and care, clinicians and counsellors have been opposed and worked in opposite ways. We can't do that anymore because we have to look at how we can deliver urgent and planned care in a very, very different way, with a very different approach. And it's not going to happen overnight, and there has to be flexibility, but we have to get that communication right. But if we do get that right, based on the figures, an additional 30 footfall per day, that might not happen at the beginning, because as you know, when there's a new service, patients may say, oh, well, I'll go to that new service. And it is about empowering clinicians then within the service to say to patients, actually, you live in Easton, you can access your hub or whatever we're going to call, whatever is delivered within your locality.
So I would, so if I can just add to that, I completely agree with all of it. Whatever the outcome is from this, we need to see it as building a new offer, not just one-off service. We need to build a new offer for urgent care for the people of Wirral and the areas beyond that use our services. Yet it does take time, but if we can make the offer in the locality with an additional GP appointments at currently 21 and hoping to be more areas, then whilst some will, what one would hope, that most would want to go down the road. I completely agree, ideally see your own GP, undoubtedly, for that continuity that you're talking about. Some things, it's okay to see something different, and a big plus we're getting now is that those extensive appointments will, with permission, have access to your notes, which is a new facility which I think makes a big difference. But some of these absolutely need continuity. What we're talking about now is additional services. No one should take away from the right thing to your own GP. Okay.
So it's briefly as I possibly can, but if you, the box we referred to last, in the case of change document, where it's cited the summary of national evidence, it's page 64, I think, impact 27, and it talks about deprivation, the significant driving factor, and actually people deprived there was presenting with a condition that could be managed better and through an Atlantic pathway. It's a later presentation of cancer, for example. It talks about people with mental health issues presenting disproportionately more than other people. And it talks about people with long-term conditions of older age presenting. What we aren't able to get across an urgent care transformation document, and where we need to have more dialogue with members of both scrutiny committees in terms of Wirral, is the focus we are putting upon the redesign of the system architecture around the neighbourhoods on the 9 areas based on local super output areas, and that those multidisciplinary teams be targeting people who make more use than others to things like A and B, about long-term conditions who are frail, who have mental health issues, and really trying to, one of our big things has to be in our 5-year vision, is how do you reduce demand on accident emergency through more proactive care, because some of that non-elective demand is failing in planned care and long-term condition management. So I just wanted to make that point that actually, whilst we are clearly scrutinising this urgent care transformation, it's part of the bigger whole about how we change how we work on the world and being more likely focused.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to break that following, and then Sharon, and then if there's no questions, I think we'll need to summarise.
Yeah. I'm just reflecting on our role as scrutiny members, and our role is to look at your proposals and hopefully to ensure that any changes meet the health needs of our population. We recognise that we've got budget constraints, people want to have a high quality health service as close to home as possible, and there are some tensions always in that that can't be met, but we want to, I'm glad to hear that you want to listen and you want to work with us.
Mm-hmm.
But I just want to really focus on the fact that outside this room there are an awful lot of people who are not happy about the proposal. You haven't persuaded them of the wisdom that, as you see it, as your of your proposal. The satisfaction levels and attachment to the walk-in service are quite high. The feedback, people like the idea of it, even if they've never used it. And that is a challenge for you, whatever you do as a result of this, that we've talked about communication. But I do think we need, you know, we're a handful of people sat around this table, but there are a lot of people out there who are not happy at the loss of their walk-in centres, and they're not convinced that what you're providing is a good enough substitute.
I think that's an absolutely reasonable point, Councillor Armstrong. But behind you there's a box with some other petitions in that we've been given tonight. We've had a presentation to our governing body today and others. So we're absolutely aware of the strength of feeling in the local population. Again, we have to take that into account in where we move forward. We will have a period of reflection now in terms of considering what comes in, including the evidence from tonight. And I think going forward, then I'd like to, in the spirit of where we need to be on this, perhaps we could reconvene about where our thinking is in a few months' time, just to keep people informed of what's going on.
Thank you, Sharon. Just some clarity, please. With the urgent treatment centre, as part of the community meetings that we've been having, you asked people whether they wanted 15 hours or 24. Why was? Can you explain why just those two options were given?
Yeah. Okay. So the urgent treatment centres, NHS England have given 27 responders that we have to comply with. One of those is a minimum requirement to be able to move 12 hours a day.
Yeah.
So we've taken that as a minimum baseline. When we've had a look at the data and the activity and the attendances at A&E and what's been offered and what people do where they're presenting, we actually believe that a 12-hour urgent treatment centre would not serve the purposes well of the activity and the behaviour patterns that we saw across Wirral. It would be better serving to put in a increased hour of opening, 15 or 24.
Why only those two figures though? Why not?
Because 15, 18. When we looked at, okay, so the 24-hour option was really looking at the activity right across the whole 24-hour stretch about what was happening for a full 12-month cycle, and recognising that whatever the policy is doing, it looked individual at 1 o'clock in the morning. And recognising there are people turning up to A&E either through ambulance or self-presenting at all hours over the 24-hour period. And so there was a genuine attempt to actually look at that activity and suggest that one option would be that people would be potentially quite well served in Wirral to permanently have 24-hour UTC as a single front door supporting A&E for that whole 24-hour period, mm-hmm. recognising that people attend whatever hour of the day or night.
Mm-hmm.
The 15-hour one was recognising that, because when we look at the cost envelope, trying to get the local offer, we could afford up to 8 hours a day in those four localities. The 15-hour came about looking at sort of an 8 o'clock to an 11 p.m., 8 a.m. to an 11 p.m. type opening, whereby that would be the majority of the attendances at A&E, not the full, but the vast majority, and so trying to mirror where the biggest footfall and biggest pressures go into A&E, and recognising balancing that with having a local offer that could be open up to 12 hours a day. So it was taking account of those factors and making some best, reasonable, sensible suggestions.
On sort of on the back of that, really. So, what
what hours would you be proposing that the extended appointments go up until? And I know that you haven't, as part of the proposal, put set locations as such yet, but how do you foresee that? Do you foresee that there will be set locations and to be arranged or to be decided, but do you see that there will be set locations in the four localities? Or do you see a position where, I live in Burpen Heads, so one day someone would have to go to Clark Medical Centre, the next day they may have to go to Miriam Medical Centre, the next day they may have to go to one of the other health centres, depending on which GP's on duty or how do you foresee that? Because that's the case, that's certainly going to cause more confusion.
Absolutely. So the number of points there, try to be very brief. Yes, we do see some of them being available in set locations. So we've described, and part of this is, we've got some parallel pieces of work that are quite neatly dovetailed in terms of time scale. So at the moment, we said we have currently 720 additional GP appointments in Wirral. Mm-hmm. The national requirement from NHS England is 7-day access, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. So those are the parameters for being able to access a GP or nurse. It's always been our intention that in the four locality service areas that we're going to agree based on the feedback, so one of them could very well be Eastern, we want to see some of those same day appointments, GP and nurse, always 7 days a week, be based in those four locality settings. But there will be additional practices supporting the neighbourhood model that will also have appointments available because we're looking at 1,440 a week GP appointments, GP and nurse appointments. So some in the four locality settings, and then additional to make up to the 1,440 a week in practices around within each of those four localities. Does that make sense?
So a hybrid.
Right, okay, so as a patient, if I was to ring Clun, I'm a patient of Clun, so if I was to ring Clun and they have now run out of extended appointments, what happens?
And there would be, so two options. We will be saying that same day access, we will keep a look at same day urgent appointments in the four settings. So if they've run out of Clun, they will advise you two things. One, right, your nearest is, we'll tell you where your nearest available appointment is in your locality area, in your neighbourhood. And we will keep some of those same day access in the four settings we've talked about. You can also clearly also go to the urgent treatment centre and walk in and be seen as well. So you'll have options. The other bit to say is that recognising that the GP appointments are only available 8 to 8, we will continue with our out-of-hours support, so the urgent treatment centre will support appointments, walk-in, but also bookable. So if you phone 111 out-of-hours, 111 has the ability to say, get yourself to the urgent treatment centre, it's midnight, get yourself there, you'll be seen in half an hour. They'll have that option as well.
So the existing GP out-of-hours provision, which there now, the long go. So you can still see a GP in the middle of the night through your normal. You ring your surgery, give you a number, you ring through, and you can get your GP out of hours.
Right, okay.
So
just answer your question,
Sharon.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think
of
what scenarios to try and get myself
to not. I do actually take your point. There is a danger in that. So when we look at the West Cheshire model and the reasons. Locations, there's a danger that because we've learned from 21 locations, then that is based upon what GPs probably want to deliver from their premises, rather than if we delivered it more from fewer locations.
What concerns me is things like, Whetstone Lane, deprived area, GP practice. Patient can't get an appointment there, and they're told that the nearest appointment for them to get to is the north end of Birkenhead, which is quite difficult for them to get from that side of Birkenhead to this side. They probably haven't got transport, they haven't got the money, there's no direct bus route, and they certainly haven't got the money to pay for a taxi. They're going out on the bus and go to Hyde Park. They are, absolutely are, straight up Woodchurch Road. That's my concern, it really is.
And it's really difficult for them because those are conversations that we're having at the moment with the GP federations, with primary care colleagues. So we have genuinely had conversations about a couple of things. One is acknowledging, talk to them about where there's particularly deprived areas, population need. So we do have to really think on the hard about how we weight appointment availability. It won't be a nice meet spread, like divided by four. It will be understanding actual population need and what we need to provide in each of those neighbourhoods. And we have started mapping with colleagues and your councillor colleagues at the end have also been close to some of this. We've started mapping actually what are the bus routes, where are those extended access appointments, actually making sure that we've got some equity so that people who are on peripheries, who do need to travel a little bit further, actually making more of those extended access appointments available in their local surgeries. So it's not a neat jigsaw piece. We've got to consider all those factors. You're absolutely right, the point you raise.
If that for our target is not met. Equally, I'd like to just touch on the fact the urgent treatment centre is mandated. Yes, it is. It is mandated. However, I can see a clinical need for exactly that. Because absolutely, it's what everybody's saying. There are some who, for whatever reason, choose to go to the Arrow Park site. I'd like to stop calling it an Arrow Park Hospital and refer to it as the Health Park. And for those people, sitting in A&E for however many hours is not a good service. So if we're going to accept that some go there, the urgent treatment centre, I think, will far more provide the right care for them than sitting in an A&E or in an area where they're not a priority, clinical priority.
What did you say for hours and years in Seacombe?
No.
After 8 o'clock, there's no more GP appointments. And you still holding to the 30 a day figure?
It's too hard.
Chris, can we... did you want to come back on that, Jackie?
Just to come back on the books, I know it's really important and you've raised it a couple of times this evening, and I'm sorry, I don't think we've been clear enough in the public about the cost and the challenges. Just to draw your attention that on bottom page 9 in the document, we do actually state around the issues around exceeding cost and load. Appreciate it might not be as strong as you'd like, but we do make reference.
Thank you. Unless it's urgent, I will then draw to a close because I think we need to look at our recommendations.
Just on your comment about taking things away, what we're trying to do and what we've been trying to do since the start of the consultation is actually stress that we don't want to take things away. What we want to do is enhance what's there, make it better for patients, and make the delivery of care better for patients, not take things away and not be open. The concept that all the concessions are closing and everybody will have to, you know, go to the Arrow Park site is absolutely not the message that I or any of my colleagues here or any of you want to get across, because that is not what we're proposing at all. It's not about taking services away. It's about improving the delivery and improving the services and enhancing the services and making sure the patients are seen in the most appropriate place to meet their clinical needs.
Thank you. I am
going
to just pose one final question, if I may, and then I'm going to suggest that we have a comfort break. And that gives the committee as well the opportunity to look at recommendations that we can put forward to you, if that's okay. So, I mean, really, it's following on from my colleague in Cheshire West. I'm glad that I'm heartened to see and to hear that you're going to consider the feedback that you're getting during the consultation. And there's going to be a huge amount of feedback that you're going to have. I mean, some of those petitions that you've collected today, I know that there's an excess of 30,000 that will long and will have comments as well. So I suppose really what I'm looking for is how you're going to consider that feedback. When would you suggest that you're going to be ready? Because I think the longer we leave it, the worse it's going to be for people. But when would you suggest that you'd be ready for us to come back as a Wirral scrutiny to post consultation and equally as a joint committee?
What we're considering at the moment is whether the level of external support we might need in looking at the consultation. Because there would be an accusation of marking your own homework, potentially. And therefore, we may need to consider, whilst it may incur additional expenditure, how we get somebody else to look at the findings for us to give us a more impartial view. It also means that the team who are currently working on this are then also freed up to do the operational management of the system, because they're trying to do this as well as operationally manage the day-to-day. We are currently exploring that as an option. It was only raised for me today as an option in the corridor. I think it's a good thing
do that. And I think what we would probably need to do is have some regular communication about when, what's happening, rather than set a date and then say, sorry, we've missed it because of not getting through the work. So I think what we want to do is establish a regular channel of communication, tell you where we're up to, and give you sort of estimated times of arrival for some of these things.
That's fair. And I suppose really what I'm a bit surprised about though is that you may have been a group of people, this is not that any one particular person, but a bit naive that you thought that you weren't going to get the amount of people that's going to take part in the consultation.
So that you
would have to look at having an independent body to look at that. I mean, could you not have looked at that a while ago, given that you're going to have to put that out to a contender, and is that going to delay the process?
I think we have had the level of interest I have anticipated, and it's a level of interest that colleagues elsewhere in the country where they've done consultations on stroke services, vascular services, maternity services have had. I think that we knew this was going to be the case, and I think it's an issue about, for me, about the partial, the impartial nature of an external body. And I think that has largely come because that's one of the questions that we've had in the last couple of days. So we could do it in-house, but given we've had the Clinical Senate come and review our processes and review the consultation, given we've made regular reference to the independent review panel, and given we've had NHS England all over this in terms of external assurance, I think it would be a good move for us now to get further external assurance, and I don't believe that any procurement process would delay that.
Okay. I think what we have to bear in mind as well, as this process goes through, we do have to look at the feedback from the Clinical Senate, which isn't finalised yet. We have to look at the, obviously, as you're saying, we have to finalise the whole feedback, all of it, and we have to bring together all the information of where we're at. And it's going to take a period of time and discuss with stakeholders how potentially we could progress forward. So what practical options are there to put to governing body? So it is correctly going to take a period of time, because whilst we'd like to no doubt have it sorted rapidly, what is most important for us is that we get the right outcome for Wirral.
Could we perhaps look then to have a draft timeline so that we can we can consider then, well, especially for officers who need to organise meetings as well, how we need to do that? So, programme really.
Sure. I just wanted to reaffirm the date, because we have this UTC being imposed on us. You didn't mention before when that's got to be done.
Well, some dates. I think this goes partly to the fact that it's not, we're not talking about big bang.
Yeah.
So the time that NHS and has asked us to work towards until the UTC is December of next year. But there is work to do towards that. The increase in extended general practice provision, nurse and duties, is from April next year. So there is a process happening, but this is not and should not be a big bang.
Right, thank you. So I think that draws this part to a close, just for the part that break. And then I can talk with colleagues from the committee with any recommendations that we might have for you to consider. You feel free to stay here, you don't want to leave the room, that's not what I'm saying.
Oh, okay. I do that.